This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to be doing something that's both very old, and in fact, older than you can probably imagine, and very new. But before we start, I'd like to go over some things about last week's show. Obviously, a lot of you saw me struggling, and I put that there for a reason, and that is that you have to understand it's a struggle to do what I do. Always with the visitors, when I write a book, some level doesn't want it written and another level does. And, you know, we wonder why they never land. I think they never land because they're fighting each other so hard. There is definitely conflict. And those of us who are in the middle of this are victims of that conflict. And that happened. And I struggled. But I'm not struggling now. I feel fabulous. And I'm ready to go. And boy, do we have a show for you today. I was simply blown away by this book that I got a hold of from Inner Traditions called Sorcerers of Stone. And we're going to now meet the sorcerer herself who created this marvelous book. Good morning.
Thank you. Camille. Thank you, Whitley. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Okay, for folks, she's going to be sort of jumping around a bit because she's in Peru, in Cusco, and there's no point in trying Zoom or anything because they'll all be like this. But you can hear her beautifully, and so don't worry about the fact that the video starts and stops a bit. Okay, Sorcerers of Stone. I think the best place to start, I've got so many questions here. Look at this. People think podcasters don't read the books. This guy, he reads the books and loves them. And I don't put on books I don't find fabulous. So anyway, let's start. Camille, give us a little bit of background, of your background. I mean, you've written one of the most remarkable books about the lost past I've ever read. I mean, it's right up there with and beyond, in some respects, the great Graham Hancock books. It's incredible. So how in the world, where did you come from, my friend?
Well, comparing me to Graham Hancock is like no, I don't even think I'm near that, but thank you very much. I landed in Peru about 13 years ago, and I fell in love with the culture, and I fell in love with the Cusco and the great walls that you see all around Cusco, the dancing that was happening at Inti Raymi, which is usually around June 23rd. It was just such a vibrant culture. And I knew that one day, I was only here for a couple weeks, and I knew I would come back because I was just fascinated with Peru. And it was only until like 5 years ago I came back, and I was only here for about 5 months. I had an extended visa, and I went back to Hawaii at that time where I was living. I was living in a Yogananda community on the Big Island called Polestar Gardens, and I happened to be caught up in the volcano that was erupting at that time. And basically, I kind of fled to California. And I said, why am I here in California? You know, it's so expensive. It's, when my heart lies in other places. And I knew I wanted to get back to Peru. So I ended up coming back to Peru in 2019. And I got caught up in the pandemic. And that gave me a lot of time to really explore the territory and look at the sites that were really in my vicinity, like Sacsig Woman, Olete Tambo, Nyapa and Glacia, and spent a lot of time really examining them. And I was noticing things that didn't really make sense when I went with guides who were telling me, oh, this was the Inca who built this, or the Quilque built this. But I noticed like three very, very different styles, you know, that were up there. And there was a style that I later found out was called by Alfredo Gamarra. It was called Hanampacha. And this was a style of construction that was actually below the megalithic sites that we see here in Peru. And it looked so weird and just so strange that it just didn't make sense to me. And when I went with guides and locals, you know, they were saying, well, the Inca built this along with the other styles, the megalithic style and the later styles. And they just seemed too incongruent to really, you know, make sense of. And so I really started looking for other explanations about what I was actually witnessing up there. And I came across the work of Jean-Peter Dejean and his website, I think Mysteries Explained. And he went into the theories of this Alfredo Gamarra and how he was explaining these three particular different styles in Sacsig Woman in the environs around Cusco. So I started exploring Gamarra's theories, and it also led me down a rabbit hole to also look into you know, Rudolf Steiner's work on early man and Madame Blavatsky's work and what they were saying about early humanity at that time. And I found a lot of correspondences in what they were seeing through the Akashic records and through spiritual meditation techniques and basically, you know, how they were seeing things like early humanity manipulating stone quite easily. There was a different type of atmosphere at that time, which made it easier for them to actually manipulate the stone. And these things were corresponding also with Alfredo Gamera's work, which was saying that the Earth had a different atmosphere at that time. Gravity, there was less gravity in the world.
The planet was physically smaller.
And that's what he was saying.
Well, in an interesting thing. Tell us about that paper that you quote from about the size of the planet. I thought that was absolutely fascinating because it's not something that conventional wisdom would agree with at all. But and yet there's really good evidence for it.
Yeah, it does seem like at one time, I mean, if you look at how the continents are shaped and, you know, it does seem like at one time they were actually, you know, it was one landmass. And I guess you could say that's Pangaea. But Pangaea basically really talks about it being on one side of a Earth that is the same size that we have today. So what various, you know, scientists have looked at in the past, and I believe it, even Tesla and Galileo, Newton, was that they thought at one time the Earth could have been smaller, and as it was expanding, the continents were breaking up and spreading, and you know, it seems like that could be a possibility. And if you have a smaller Earth with a smaller mass, it would seem like gravity would also, we would be under less gravitational forces, right?
Yeah, the paper I was referring to is David Noel's paper. Perhaps it's slipped your mind under the pressure that happens. It's called, folks, David Noel, it's the Ben Franklin Center for Theoretical Research in Australia, and it is called Continental Drift and Earth Expansion. And it is really a fascinating paper because it gives you an entirely different vision of what the past of this planet may have been like. And I think that since it's clear to any of us who look at the past with any kind of real open mind, the past of mankind was very different. Now, let me ask you now another question. It seems a perfect time for this question to come in, which is, and we're going to take a break before you answer, so take a breath. Humans were different in constitution in the past. This is critically important, I think. Mm-hmm. Right. They could do different things. They had different powers. They lived in a different way and in a different world. And we're in trouble in our world because we don't have their powers. So I want you to tell us a little bit when we come back about their different powers and their different world. We'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're talking to Camille Sauvé. Her book, her remarkable book, Sorcerers of Stone. She has a website, sorcerersofstone.com, where you can explore articles and get in contact with her if you have questions. I'm sure she'll answer them. This book is really extraordinary. Before we left the air, I asked the question about the humans of the past being different in constitution. And yeah, there's a lot of material in the book about this that I found quite fascinating. Can you talk about it a little bit?
Yeah, basically, I was referring a lot of the work of Madame Blavatsky, basically her secret doctrine, volume 2, Anthropogenesis, really speaks to how human beings at one time were more spiritual. As we became, and as the earth began to materialize, human beings actually started materializing with humans. This is part of the doctrine of theosophy. So this is also what Rudolf Steiner also speaks about, that humans were, we seeded this earth like many eons ago. Perhaps it went in our more spiritual state. This could have been back hundreds of millions of years. So
when you say a more physical state, you're literally suggesting that we were not as dense physically as we are now.
Yeah, I think the word they describe it as more plasticine. There was a time where we were more like of a gaseous substance. And over a period of millions of years, we started to come to the state that we are today, which is our forms today, but
extremely physically complex and very dense.
Right.
Like over-designed machines.
Yes. And that also came, we evolved with the earth in that respect, that we were, the gas, the earth was at one time a gas planet. And then it started to congeal. Humans were also involved with this evolution with Earth. So we were really part of, of this planet. We are.
This is such an important concept, because initially when you hear this with a Western mind, you think, oh, no, that can't be true. But when you think of it differently, that we have always been part of the planet. We are part of the earth. And in my life, the more I have come to accept and bring that into my consciousness and my reality, the deeper my journey has become and the more profoundly connected to the earth it has become. We became disconnected from the earth somehow. Mm-hmm. Right. But before we go on, I want to go back to the early, is it Hanapacha? What is the earliest?
Yes, those were, there were actually three different terms that Alfredo Gamarra describes for the archaeology around, not only around Peru, but you can see these forms like everywhere around the world.
In the world, folks.
Yes.
This is not just Peru. This was a world-girdling civilization, and some of the illustrations in the book are going to shock you, because you can see that this strange ability to shape stone and stuff wasn't limited to Peru at all. But what I wanted to make is this. You mentioned in the book, the Inca Empire lasted it ended when the Spaniards came, but it started in what, about 600 AD?
That's what they call the imperial, Inca. They believe there was a pre-imperial Inca period that was probably around 1200 CE time. This was a period that really started from the Tiwanaku area, and right. There was a group of people. With the Inca royal leadership coming from that area, and they established, according to conventional history of pre-Columbia, they established Cusco, and it was around the time of. Mm-hmm.
You make a point that they could not possibly have built all of this in that time. It's just said that it's all Inca. They say that because we don't they don't understand, and they dismiss it. It's dismissing. It's typical of Western Eurocentric thinking. They dismiss the past. Mm-hmm. That's, they don't explain it. They dismiss it.
Right.
And that's dismissing the past to say that these people could do this impossible thing.
Yeah, and there's been a few professors of pre-Columbian, history who basically said what happens here in Peru is they try to fit archaeological evidence into a historical narrative, and they try they basically give the huacas, which are called the sacred sites here, attribute them to certain Inca kings because they often had a priest class that did ceremonies and oracle readings for the Inca priest. And that is why archaeology sites tend to get associated with the Inca Empire, even though these things are much, much older than, than the Inca doing their ceremonies there. In fact, when you talk to people locally, many of the Quechua speaking people here will say, oh no, these things are so much older. They were older than when our ancestors, came here and established settlements. So, this is actually what the Spanish chroniclers actually recorded too. And they recorded that in Sacsayhuaman, they recorded that in Tiwanaku, that when they asked the locals who built Tiwanaku, the locals said, well, it wasn't us. Some of them laughed and they said, no way, we could build this. So it is in the historical records that even the people who have been here for a long time, the Amara, were saying they were much more ancient civilizations that were before their culture. So
do you point out some of the shapes are so extraordinary, and the illustrations in the book really make that clear. And you'll see some of them in those of you who are watching on the video as we go along.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing, he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us, and his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
Okay, so you'll see. But we're going to, as we talk now, some of the older shapes will come up. And Is there any why to this? Do we understand these shapes at all?
There's some theories about why you see so many knobs and what they call here intibatanas, which are kind of the hitching posts of the sun. The theories tend to run that it's tracking solstices and equinoxes or certain significant star systems at certain times of the year. But it is kind of a puzzle because there's so many of them and they can be interpreted so many different ways. Yes. And lining up to so many constellations and phenomenon. But it does seem like some of them are actually tracking equinoxes of some of these intibatanas. But the interesting thing is the knobs. A lot of the knobs don't seem to have random patterns. And, some of them look like almost like a braille system. And, as far as I know, I can't figure out why some of the megaliths have them and some don't. And they don't seem to be situated where it's meant for lifting the rocks, which a lot of conventional archaeologists believe is what they were for. But they seem to be off balance from the rock, so it wouldn't be an easy thing to lift these things up, as the center of balance is completely off with a lot of these knobs. So a lot of them just seem like there's a mystery, or maybe they're focusing some kind of energy on these knobs. And I actually went with a friend recently who's a sensitive up to the Moon Temple area in Soxi Woman. And I was watching her as she touched one of these intibatanas on the rock, and she actually had a shock. and she kind of jumped back and she goes, whoa. So there might be something to these being focal points of energy, and maybe people put their hands, and intentions on these stones. I would be interested, and I actually put out the word to the biogeometry community that it would be great if we actually get some people to come to Peru. Yeah. So we can actually do some study of how shapes and energies affect the human biology the energy of the space. Because they're very connected. In
biogeometry. This is folks.
Great! Wow.
Biogeometry.
Yes, I recognize
that. Samuel is very, very important to me, because it helps me. These things are real. We live in a in the Western world. We live in, and you can look up biogeometry, and you'll find out all about it. That's not what this show is about. So we're not going to go there today. In any case, the Western mind is shrunken, literally shrunken. It is in a state of denial about what the real world is. And that has to be understood very clearly when we're talking to someone like Camille, because your Western, the prison of the Western, of Western rationality is constantly telling you, no, this can't be true, that can't be true. And it all has to be a linear progression that essentially, deeply and profoundly, makes no sense whatsoever. Right. None.
Yeah.
It's not real.
Yeah,
the greatest illusion we are living with now is Western rationality. But beyond that, there is a bigger rationality, stronger, more true, and actually more rational. Okay, off the hobby horse or whatever it is. Now, what about all of these sediments that are there? The whole area, you would think that there must have been a very different climate at some point there. Am I touching this correctly? I think I might be. I'm not sure. you make the point that there are so many sediments, and I thought to myself, was the weather different? Like for example, the period, the Inca period, it was only so long, and yet there's so much sediment involved with these ruins, and it right. couldn't have all deposited in that period, could it?
Yeah, and that's the thing with the Hanampacha work. A lot of it is still under, 10, 20 meters of sediment. And, I don't know if the audience is familiar with Sacsayhuaman, but it is on a hill above Cusco. And Cusco is kind of, some of you may have heard of, is the navel of the universe in the Andean region. And navels tend to be considered as hot spots or energy centers. But anyway, Sacsayhuaman is above that, and it's kind of on a platform. And this is where you see a lot of this Hanampacha work, and you're wondering, where did the sediment come from? There are some hills around that particular area, but it doesn't seem like, even with the major rains that tend to happen in the Andes, it doesn't seem like you would have this kind of a sediment buildup, which you see on these older sites. I mean, some of them are buried so deeply. And that's another thing regarding the Hanampacha work, is that it tends to be the kind of formations that you see for the cave systems, which are all over Cusco region. A lot of these go quite deep into the earth. And there was recently a study done by a geophysicist. His name was Andrei Veronov. He had ground penetrating radar, which was over an area called Cochicancha. And basically it's an amphitheater, which is right near the colossal walls of Sacsayhuaman. And with this ground penetrating radar, they actually discovered three shafts that went down. They went down to about 30 to 40 meters. And there was really no explanation for him for these shafts. And they said they can't be natural. So it seems like somebody was building vast cave systems underneath Sacsayhuaman. And they, there are many historical legends about cave systems which go from the Coricancha, which is the sun temple in Cusco, all the way up to Sacsayhuaman, and also to Lake Titicaca. So this is a very prevalent myth. And I wouldn't even say it's a myth, because you can actually see these caves and go through some of them that aren't buried by the Ministry of Culture and the government. So
now, does the government bury this? Why do they try so hard to conceal this? Is it that they're afraid of danger? Or?
Yes, yeah. And a number of people have been lost in them. I believe there was a team from Lima University, I think it was in the 30s, and they were exploring the cave systems. And I believe when they set out, they had, I think it was like 15 people, and only a couple of them actually came out of the cave system. So people have gotten lost. The ones that have come up, many of them have gone crazy from being underground for days at a time. The interesting thing, it's a little bit of an aside here, is that there's a lot of people here who believe in what they call duendes, which are goblins. And if you walk around these places and you ask about these things, many people will acknowledge them and basically say that, they're here, even presently. there are beings that are living underground. So, you know, and this brings up other phenomena that we're finding here in Peru that are quite strange. Like recently, the Nazca mummies are actually getting a lot of publicity, negative.
I'm heavily involved with the Nazca mummies.
Yeah.
I'm very up on that, and I'm contributing some money to another study of the mummies that's going to take place very shortly. And so, yeah, I know about the Nazca mummies, and I've thought to myself, maybe we're looking at the people who built this stuff.
Yeah, no, you know, that's, I mean, in my book, I do bring up the Lemurians and what Rudolf Steiner had witnessed in the Akashic records. And he does talk about the early Lemurians as living in caves, but that doesn't discount that other people or other forms of life are also not living underneath. And I'd like to point out, I have this great book called The Power of the Andes by Manuel Portugal. And I was really stunned to see a section here where he describes, you know, there's an ancient lineage of keepers of wisdom here in the Andes. And they tend to be underground in Ucupacha. And he claims there's 120 civilizations that are living underground. Seems pretty incredible, but you know, when you notice that these chinkanas or cave systems are really everywhere around here, and also in Central America, and probably, you know, in Europe and Middle East, you have to wonder what's under our feet. You know, what's underground. I mean, I've just heard so many stories of people here who talk about the duendes. Some say they've seen them, you know, and I have a neighbor, his name is Jose, and he told me he was working for the Ministry of Culture on a dig in the mountains above PSAC, and he came across in a cave system a mummy. And it was only this big. And this isn't in Nazca, this is in PSEC in the Sacred Valley. And he mentioned it had an elongated head, and, a stature of 1 meter, you know, it's pretty incredible when you think about it. And he told me, the archaeologist took it down to the Garcia Losa de Vega Museum in Cusco. And I went down there, and they said, no, we don't have it. We shipped it off to the Nazca region. And I said, well,
yeah, down to the university there. That's where
they're located. the Ica University. Yeah. And I said, well, you know, this was a PSAC mummy. It's not from Ica, so which, you know, technically it should have stayed here in the PSAC region, but I've recently I took a trip to a mountain it's a little bit to the northeast of PSAC, and it looks like a pyramid. And my guide was telling me, he was from the area. He said, we frequently see duendes around here, goblins, and he said, sometimes we see light beams up here on the mountain peak. So, you know, just interesting stories.
What exactly did duendes look like?
Well,
people describe them to you?
Yeah, they're really known in the mining regions of Peru. And they tend, now I've heard stories, they're smaller than humans. In stature, and many of them have beards, which is kind of interesting. Bigger eyes, kind of more of a roundish face. We even have amusement parks here for duendes, in the Cusco area, and they're set up with kind of leprechaun-looking, dwarves and gnomes and stuff like that. So,
well, you know, in Bavaria, they are known or were known in the Middle Ages as kobolds. They lived in mines. And if you look at under southern Bavaria, there is a honeycomb of tunnels that are mostly too small for people to go through that were carved by somebody. And of course, they explain them as being carved by children in the Middle Ages for reasons that are a little obscure, but there are quite a lot of them. So we could be talking about something that has been worldwide, and you have to wonder what happened, because we're not like that now. We've fallen off the path. We're not on the true human path anymore, and the result of this is we're going straight down to a situation where we have an exploding population, an uncontrollable situation, economic systems that can't stop growing, that are like tumors on the planet. We're in trouble. And how in the world have we gotten there from where we were? And that gets me to the question of the vitrified forts and the vitrified stone. Can you tell us a little bit about the vitrified stone and why it might be vitrified, and also, please, what the word vitrified means?
Vitrified is kind of it's where you turn the surface material into a glass-like substance, and it usually, in reference to rock sites, it's in the case of here in Peru, it seems to be in these cave systems and grottos. And it's very shiny. It reflects the light. It seems to be applied not necessarily all over a cave, but just in certain spots on certain angles. So it's kind of a very strange phenomenon. And people haven't figured out what is the process of actually vitrifying stone inside of a cave. There's been some theories about using parabolic mirrors that would shine the light into the cave to kind of create the heat necessary. But some of this is so deep inside these caves that the light and the heat would dissipate. So it really doesn't. It hasn't been proven that that's the way rock was vitrified. So there was a paper recently by Dejong, and I'm trying to remember the guy. But anyways, they did a study of this vitrified rock, and they found that it was composed of silica, magnesia, and aluminum, I believe, and it replicates some of the glazes in pottery that they discovered in Argentina. But when you have like silica and magnesium, you tend to have it tends to interact with energies, I kind of speculate that this could have been used for communication by individuals who are inside the cave, because there's so much of this in these Hanampacha rock formations that, maybe this is a way in the dark, when it wasn't very light, that people could communicate. But it's a very interesting phenomenon in how they did it. I think you have to have temperatures of about 2,500 degrees in order to create that.
2,500 degrees.
That's an extremely high heat. So,
however they did it, it's not how we think. And incidentally, folks, there are also vitrified ruins in Scotland, in northern Scotland. So this is a worldwide phenomenon, and equally mysterious to how they generated the heat. And speaking of light and heat in caves. The caves in southern France and northern Spain, which are full of beautiful artworks, not to mention many of the subterranean remains in Egypt, there's no sign of any torch carbon anywhere. This means very simply that for a very long time, mankind could make things in places that are now dark and create enormously high temperatures without leaving any carbon deposits.
Yeah.
What happened?
It's very strange.
What happened is we've lost something, or something has been taken.
Some technology,
You know, G.R. Gurdjieff, whose work I have studied for many years, for those of you who don't know, he was an Armenian. I guess the best way to call him would be a sort of seeker and philosopher who went across Tibet and all through that area and beyond, Afghanistan and other Kyrgyzstan and places like that, looking for answers as to the questions of the mysteries of the world. And one of the things he came up with was, at some point, something was taken from us or put into us that broke our connection with the earth. He called it the organ kunda buffer. That is to say, kundalini buffer, that buffers our connection to the planet. And we were talking, Camille and I, earlier about how the people of the past were literally much more part of the planet and have been that way since the beginning. We haven't been created. We've always been part of the planet. Consciousness has always been part of the planet. And it gradually coalesced into physical beings at probably at different times during the planet's life. We are such beings, and we've become too dense. We're physically too dense. And this whole ideation of consciousness on Earth is going to end because of that. And it's too bad, but it just is the fact. And the next ideation is going to start differently, and it'll probably be lighter. And they'll understand. Maybe they'll even go back and repair some of these ruins.
Well, there's also theories. I'm sure you're familiar with the Anunnaki, theories of Mesopotamia and how they were doing genetic manipulation on humanity. So, you know, there may have been many multi forms of humanity and other entities that were living with us. And if we had extraterrestrial life come in and tweak us, you know, and manipulate us, I believe there is something in the Popol Vuh, which is the book of creation from the Aztecs, that indicated that there were gods who were manipulating our genetics, and they didn't want us as smart as they were.
They weren't gods. They were just people who we decided to call gods because we didn't understand them and saw they had great power. And as you point out in the book, cargo cults did that in World War II, when they saw the amazing stuff coming out of the planes. And then after the war, they gradually gave up because it became obvious that their magic could not produce any more cases of beer because basically the Air Force was gone.
Right.
Now, if you go back to the very earliest religions that we know of, the earliest documents are in the Pyramid of Unas in Egypt. It goes back to, I think it's about 4,000 years old. And what it describes at the beginning of the, as you walk into the pyramid, the hieroglyphics describe a very different vision of the human body than we have now. And that vision is that the spine is basically an accelerator that accelerates experience that we're gathering from the physical world into the second body, into the non-physical body, which in turn delivers it to the soul, which is a very passive element in the human being, and will persist. That soul is what will persist after death, but it's not individual. It's part of a larger thing. So when my wife died, one of the first things she said was, "I'm not Anne anymore, but I will always be Anne for you." And that, I think, is what she was describing. Anyway, so we lost all of that. Now let's go on. I want to go back to some more substantive stuff, because I think I'm moving a little bit off the book. The book, by the way, is Sorcerers of Stone. It's sorcerersofstone.com. You can learn more and engage with Camille, I'm sure. And it's really fabulous and filled, packed with great illustrations. Excellent photography in the book. And it's going to get you thinking in ways that we don't think and we're not supposed to think. Well, here on this show, that's how you are supposed to think. So let's try thinking in a new way. And that said, free Dreamlanders, it's time for us to say goodbye. And we get very few subscriptions these days. And I keep on supporting the site as I always have and will do, obviously, until I can't anymore. But I would like your support and help very much. So why don't you go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today? Just do it. And don't be passive. Something will come to you if you subscribe. Namely, access to a beautiful website with an incredible, wonderful community, social community behind it that is not full of trolls and cruel people and fools. They're people like you, good people. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next week. Subscribers, let's keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.